want to congratulate Ben on you know, putting together this great program. He got hit a little bit with the unlucky stick with the keynotes, but he's in good Austin fighter strategy, bobbed and weaved and took care of it. And the papers today have been great. It's a great project. Thanks to Amy and Templeton for the support. And it's always wonderful to come here and see what is going on at Texas Tech. I have a long love affair with Texas Tech because, as Ben knows and some other you know, I kind of have a weird thing about basketball. And in my opinion, perhaps the greatest female basketball player, certainly greatest college female basketball player, Cheryl Swoop played here. And I can remember her winning the national title here at Texas Tech and being very excited about that. And that kind of, you know, reminds me of the fact that I'm filling in for Deirdre McCloskey. And in situations like that, I'm always reminded, how many here know the name Babe Dickerson Zaharias? Okay, so she was in the first half of the 20th century. She's the greatest female athlete. And she married this guy, Zaharias, who was a professional wrestler. And he looked like, you know, he was unbelievably, you know, fit and everything like that. And later in life, she used to say, he became very rotund. And she used to say, as a joke, she'd say, you know, look, I married a Greek god, and instead I just got a goddamn Greek. And so, unfortunately for you tonight, you have a goddamn Greek up here, rather than the great Deirdre McCloskey. And so I apologize up front for that, because I imagine many of you were really looking forward to hearing her talk, and she is one of the most articulate and forceful speakers for the liberal society at the moment. And so go read her ideas and do with that. I have a more mundane topic, but it's related, which is on the relationship between regulation and entrepreneurship and how that ties into the free society. And I'll come back to this. This is joint work with J.R. Clark. Before I get started, for those of you who are into empirical economics, what I'm trying to do, what we're trying to do in this is basically arbitrage across three literatures. Okay, the first one is the new literature on reg data, which is available from Mercatus, and I highly recommend that all of you go online. Patrick McLaughlin's done a fantastic job with this data, and you can get the whole sort of regulatory burden in the United States economy. And then what we're doing is looking at the Economic Freedom Index as well. What is the overall economic environment that takes place in countries and what's its impact on entrepreneurship? And then Kaufman data on startups and the role that startups play in employment in the US economy. And you know, look, Josh made reference to this. I was a student of Bob Tullison's, actually co-authored a paper with Bob Tullison. I'm very proud of that. But Bob used to say that I practice, you know, optical least squares. That was my approach to economics. So in my second book, actually, if you go and look in the back of it, I have all this scattergrams and everything like that. And Bob once asked me about it. I said, Austrian econometrics there, Bob. There it is. Optical least squared. And I'll explain why I think that's okay, by the way, to do that in a second. I'm not saying it's the greatest approach. It's just one among many approaches. But what we're trying to do is arbitrage across these three literatures and examine what's happened to entrepreneurship in America and what has policy done to either hinder or promote entrepreneurial activity. By promote, I should say up front, I don't mean government subsidizing entrepreneurship. Many years ago, I was David Aldrich. Those of you who are in the field of entrepreneurship, David Aldrich is one of the leading scholars in that. He's more of an empirical entrepreneurship scholar. He and I were invited over to Europe to meet with all the leading students in entrepreneurship and judge the graduate student papers. And I gave lectures on Kirzner and entrepreneurship, and he gave papers more or less on an empirical examination of entrepreneurship. And the paper that won was on the Self-Employment Act in Germany. Now, what happened, Josh brought up a great point the other day about a natural experiment in Germany. They have East Germany, West Germany, and then they unified. Well, what happened, if you remember, you go back, what Chancellor Kohl did was he did a one-to-one currency, all right, which had a big impact for the post-unification kind of economy, because the real wages of East Germans just shot through the roof. As a result, they had massive unemployment, 20% unemployment in East Germany, the former East Germany, whereas they had very low unemployment in West Germany, now the former West Germany. So what did they do to fix it? They decided they were going to now allow for self-employment. So not a job retraining program, but subsidies for people to go into entrepreneurship. And this student was studying that natural experiment. What happened because of that? And in my comment, which was written up, I called it turning lemons into lemonade, all right, with the water, the sugar, and the lemons provided by the state. And my point was, that's really crappy lemonade. Okay, and so we have to look at that, the composition of those things, and whether or not those entities are actually viable or not, as opposed to just activity. So I'm totally against kind of incubators and universities that try to claim that you need to get subsidies to do all that. So I apologize if Texas Tech has a big incubator lab and all of that kind of stuff. At George Mason, they always make these grandiose claims about millions of dollars are going to come to George Mason because of the incubator, and they don't materialize. So that's not what I mean by helping entrepreneurship. All I mean is cultivating an environment in which individuals can, in fact, bet on ideas. Entrepreneurship is really a simple idea. You need to have the willingness to bet on ideas and the finances available to finance the betting on ideas. That's it. You just have to encourage people betting on ideas and put up with the idea that a good part of the ideas fail. So it is a profit and loss system. So we have to go through that. So, but America has a unique sort of role in the entrepreneurship sector. Now, this is, my wife makes fun of me all the time, not because I'm a bad Greek or whatever, but because she says it's PowerPoint, Pete, not paragraphs. But this is Jerry Gunderson. Many of you are involved with Appy and whatnot, and Jerry Gunderson's a major person in Appy. But he also was a serious scholar of entrepreneurship and economic history, and that people should recognize that. And this is from his book called The Wealth Creators, which is an entrepreneurial history of the United States. And like Jonathan Hughes, or today Joel Mulcair, Gerald Gunderson was a major contributor to the literature of understanding the relationship between entrepreneurship and economic growth. And what he talks about here is the transition coming out of World War II of how the United States became the leading entrepreneurial economy in the world. All right, and that wasn't because of regulations or anything like that. It was because, relatively speaking, we opened up opportunities for people to bet on ideas and find the financing to bring those bets to life. And so we become the wealthiest economy in the world, this then has continuing increasing returns to it. It's one of the issues. This is how you get non-scalers. Right, is that you build on these and build on them and build on them. But this is what's going on in terms of restrictions. So this is the number of federal restrictions. This comes from the reg data. All right, and so you can see the regulatory burden. So how many here remember Milton Friedman's Free to Choose? Okay, remember the scene when he goes and does the shelves on the Federal Register of restrictions in the economy? And he shows what it was like, and then he shows the number of shelves that it took place now. Well, go to Reg Data and watch Patrick McLaughlin do it by piling them up and filling in a room. It's an amazing picture for you. It's almost like, you know, Hans Riesling type, you know, infographics or whatever, showing you the number of regulations. So this has exploded. Well, what else do we have? This is from BLS, Bureau of Labor Statistics. And this is jobs created by new firms as the federal restrictions have risen. So if you see here, what's going on is that the number of jobs that are being created are actually declining by the new firms, right? And so this is a very simple sort of economics of this, this is what drives what we're trying to do. So correlation isn't causation, right? Optical least squares is not enough. All right, I know that, but Andre Schleifer, so who mentioned it? Oh, Ben made fun of me for liking Schleifer. I like all the economists that like me, it's a very simple rule. If they like me a lot, I like them a lot. Schleifer told me early on, he said, listen, many a scattergram is proven to be a spurious correlation upon sophisticated statistical analysis. But no sophisticated statistical analysis that's economically significant isn't first seen in the scattergram. Is everyone following that? Okay. So you can learn a lot by just this sort of raw things. It doesn't mean that's the end of the analysis, but it gives you a pattern of what you're trying to explain. And so this pattern is indicative of something that we must explore. Basically, more regulation, less entrepreneurship, or different types of entrepreneurship. I should say that too, back off a second, which is, there is this Baumol article, productive, unproductive entrepreneurship. So it's not that entrepreneurship disappears. It's that it gets redirected into activity which is not win-win situations, but instead into zero-sum games. So this relates to what Easterly was saying. There's tremendous entrepreneurship in Washington, D.C. all the time, but it's in order to get zero-sum wins rather than positive-sum gains. It's not wealth-creating, it's what? Rent-seeking, right? To be very clear on this, Bob is a graduate of Hillsdale. I love Hillsdale, but in the early 90s, I gave a talk at Hillsdale about my stuff on the Soviet Union, and I was talking about the rent-seeking society, and one of the elderly individuals who support Hillsdale came up to me after I was done and said, "Professor, I loved your talk. It was wonderful. It was a great talk. I never knew it was all the landlord's fault." And I was like screaming, "No, no, come back here. I don't mean that." But she was very happy that now I identified the landlords as the evil people of the world. So we want to look at entrepreneurship as opportunity pursuit. It's a very simple kind of idea, alertness. Right? We're going to be alert to that which is in our interest to be alert to, right? And we're going to recognize those gains from trade. And the marginal benefit, marginal cost calculus impacts entrepreneurship just as any other decision. And this is a quote from Kirzner arguing that entrepreneurship is literally just the same thing as decision making. In a model of man, which sees man as a purposive being, every act is an act of entrepreneurship. It's an act to be alert to that which is in your interest to be alert to. It's an act which recognizes previously unrecognized opportunities to do what? Substitute an unsatisfactory state of affairs for a future better state of affairs. All right? It's also one of the reasons why prices have to serve as a guide, because it's all action is always future oriented. Never about the past. It's always the future oriented. So how do I have mechanisms to help us understand how to make future decisions? We need all kinds of institutions that help us in that. And the most fundamental of them are property, prices, and profit loss. With absent property, prices, and profit loss, you're going to direct entrepreneurship in different kind of areas. So we want to study, in fact, innovation within firms, innovation within industries, innovation within the economy. These are the prime movers of progress. So these are all the things that you guys are studying when you do the various impact. So if you think about immigration, what is the channel with which immigration generates the benefits that Ben identified? Right? It's that they go into entrepreneurial wealth creation. That's where they go, that's where that activity gets directed in. All right, again, just to mention Schleifer, at the Southerns this year, he gave a paper on educating entrepreneurs. One of the gentlemen here raised the question about education in East and West Germany, and Schleifer used data on human capital investment in Germany and was looking in whether he wants to identify human capital as the key ingredient. Well, one of the things I asked him was, I said, "Well, Andre, what about if we included East German measures in there after World War II? Along with West German ones?" And he said, "Oh, we're only dealing with market societies." But isn't that he misses the whole point then, because the comparison is the institutions. So there's a difference between East Germany and West Germany and the way in which human capital will be invested, and the returns on it are going to depend on those different institutional patterns. And that's kind of what we want to study. And so by eliminating the institutional difference, you eliminate the very thing that you're trying to study. So it's a bad strategy to do. And, you know, this is one of the messages of Ben's project here, is to study the origins of economic prosperity and freedom And those, in fact, all fall down on the idea of the institutional constellation that you find yourself in. What are those institutions? And if you don't have those institutions, you're not going to have the kind of prosperity and freedom that you expect to get out of a progressing economy. So this is a, sort of the Baumol paper, which just sort of, again, puts the idea that the entrepreneur is the entrepreneurial activity is the foundation for looking at innovation within firms, within industries, and within economies. That is, in fact, the prime mover. And any economics that squeezes the entrepreneur out of its economics, by definition, it doesn't provide the right economic theory for us to study progress. Right? Is everyone with me on that? So you can't study economic progress by studying perfect competition models. It's just not, it's the wrong tool for that question. It's a tool for a theory of stasis, but not a tool of dynamics. If you want to study the dynamics of progress, you got to understand, basically, economics can't be treated as a closed-ended system. In fact, progress is all about the open-endedness, the voyage into the unknown, creativity. This is what we want to sort of look at, and what are the activities that open that up? So what are these economic policy for an entrepreneurial society? Well, again, not anything exciting for any of you who haven't noticed. You all know we can redirect entrepreneurship productive or unproductive activity. We can also direct it in destructive activity, but I'm leaving that aside for right now. Just productive and unproductive. So you have the constellation of institutions and commercial practices. So now let me make an idea of McCloskey. Okay? So here's a big thing of McCloskey. It's sweet talk. Right? It's the rhetoric under which what? Commercial enterprises engage in. So again, sweet talk about entrepreneurship. Do we attribute dignity to the people who engage in entrepreneurship, or do we attribute, you know, some kind of hatred and despising of those people? All right? An old joke, there's sort of two Soviet jokes that I'll tell you about, and then also a Soviet, post-Soviet practice. There's an old Soviet joke, which is that a Russian, a Frenchman, and a Britishman find a genie. And the genie's going to give them each a wish, so three wishes. So it turns to the Frenchman and says, what would you like? And he says, a bountiful vineyard with many mistresses. Okay? And then turns to the British guy and says, what do you want? The British guy says, a beautiful home overlooking the North Sea. Then turns to the Russian. The Russian scratches his beard, thinks for a second, then says, my neighbor has a goat. I don't have a goat. Kill my neighbor's goat. Okay? That's a Russian joke. That's not an American joke about Russians, okay? And so that tells you something about the fatalistic attitude, the span of control, all kinds of other things, which we don't have to go into now. But that's kind of like, how do you overcome that? So in 1992, when Russia freed up its markets, remember that they passed the law of cooperatives in 1987, while Gorbachev was still in power. And the law of cooperatives said the following thing. If you go out and try to open a cooperative, which meant legally a cooperative, you'd have to pay 67% tax on the goods that you sold. But if you stay at the state price, then, you know, the tax isn't that high. So a Russian joke went, a state shortage of buns and a state shortage of sausage became a sandwich sold out the back window. And that's why you had the announcement of, we're going to allow all acts between consenting capitalist adults, but yet you still had a Russian black market. Right? That's, you should have said, like, should have had a V8. Like, what's going on here? If all acts between consenting capitalist adults are legal, you shouldn't have a black market. The fact that you had a black market is indication that there was, you know, these issues in there. So what was one of the things that happened? Because remember, in Russia, what did you sort of argue on the official economy? This is one of the reasons why the transition was so difficult in terms of the democratic politics being introduced at the same time that you had market transitions. Because what's one of the problems with the existing Soviet system? All right, one. Most people woke up at the wrong place at the wrong time to go to the wrong job. So now what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to shut down those firms, and they're going to have, so you're going to have unemployment. Again, you guys are too young in here, but there's an old Soviet joke. Brezhnev, as you might have read in the history book sort of was brain dead for a while. And he used to have two guys that would carry him around. And when he finally officially died, they didn't have a job. And that was the first case of Soviet unemployment. One, just note what I just said. You're going to now have firms that need to shut down, which workers that are in those firms no longer have a job. So now you have unemployment. Just count that. What's the next thing you're going to do? What's the problem with Soviet economy? It's a shortage economy. You had to queue up to get your goods, which meant what? That the price was set below the market clearing price. So now, in order to fix it, you need to let prices go up to their market clearing price. To the average everyday layman, not the economist, that means prices are going to rise. To the economist, we know that prices are actually falling because the real price would be the Q price plus the official price, right? But to the layman, they used to get it for a kopeck. Now they have to pay a ruble. They call that inflation. So put that as your second thing, all right? Now, we're going to allow firms to enter into the market, and they're going to be able to supply goods and services to people, and in order to do it, they're going to get profits. And what does that give us? Inequality. So now I'm a Democratic politician running on an economic reform program, and my program says, hey, vote for me. I'm going to give you unemployment, inflation, and income inequality. In the history of mankind, this has never been a winning platform in the Democratic reforms. So there you have, you know, Russia during the 1990s. Now, what goes on during the 1990s is there's still some of this activity and people doing it. And one of the activities, don't trust me, look it up, one of the activities that neighbors would do when someone made too much money is they would stab them in the butt. Now, stabbing you in the butt is not as bad as getting stabbed in the heart because, you know, butts are fleshy and you get stabbed and it's annoying. It's called a pain in the ass for a reason. But it's not like, so it was annoying. It's the same thing as happened in Ireland and in New Zealand. It's called the tall poppy syndrome. If some people make too much money, they cut the poppy down. It's a sort of a common, you know, backlash against economic reforms. In those kind of environments, people will be less entrepreneurial, or they'll be entrepreneurial in the ways that doesn't lead to the knife getting poked at you, right? Which does what? Redirects towards politics, redirects towards, so you can have privileges. If I have privileges, no one gets to poke me. Right? And so you end up by having a different kind of entrepreneurial activity. And this is one of so we have to beware of rent seeking and the redirecting of entrepreneurial activity. Unless you have private property rights, freedom of prices, profit loss accounting. Now think through the institutions. For all you graduate students right now, write those down and then think. Here's an exercise for you. Write down a simple present value calculation. And then try to figure out what institutions are required for you to do that calculation. And then you'll see the brilliance of Mises' insight, right? In my opinion, the greatest economist that ever lived. So I was thrilled when Ben invited me to come down here. Do you have the same name? They give you my name.
Only you.
Was the Ludwig von Mises professor. Yeah, so I have it, I'm very proud. Anyway.
I'm the feedback keeper, professor. Yeah.
Rightfully so. <Yeah. laughs> The Babe Dickerson Zaharias one, that's who you are. All right. So we have to really, you know, we have to look at these, you know, what the role that private property plays, what the role that relative prices play in guiding, what profits in luring, what losses in penalizing. It's an amazing constellation of a set of institutions and practices, and in its absence, as Mises pointed out, we're so many steps in the dark. And so what happens is you redirect your activity to be away from the dark, but that doesn't mean that you're going to realize wins and wins. So we have to always be aware of that and we're weary of the rent-seeking society. Now, where does this rent-seeking society come in? So public policy is actually pretty simple. You look for incentive-compatible policies, and then you look for incentive-compatible strategies to implement the policies. Any of you have worked in public policy, this is the way you have to think. Think about that, Jim, right? I want to do a privatization policy. I'm going to have to take into account what would be the winning coalition. I need to have incentive-compatible policies and then incentive-compatible strategies. I can't expect God, a benevolent saint or whatever, to put in my policies. Real flesh and blood people are going to put in my policies. This is one of Buchanan's major insights. It's called, we have to begin from the here and now. we negotiate from the status quo. You kind of gave no particular status to the status quo morally. It was an economic argument. We begin with the status quo. All right? And so what happens when we have things like the precautionary principle in effect? Well, what it's going to do is shut down innovation, because I'm going to have to prove in advance of an innovation that the innovation will never have any harm on anyone. Right? Permissionless cars. Let me go on record. So my wife makes fun of me about this one, too. I'm driving with her out to the beach, and it's around Memorial Day. And so the cops in Virginia and Delaware and Maryland are saying, we have a zero tolerance policy for kids drinking, right? And I turn to my wife and I go, the optimal amount of drunk driving this season is not zero. And she looks at me and says, no wonder no one listens to economists. And I'm like, no, let me explain to you. I don't want to hear you. But let me go on record. We're going to get driverless cars. And someone's going to be in an accident. And someone's going to die. And we'll have all kinds of investigations of it. And we'll find out most likely it's because the person that was sitting in the front seat of the Google car just decided, for whatever reason, to drive themselves now. And then they killed them, right? They did it. Will you end up by banning driverless cars because of that? If we did that in our history, we'd still be eating stones for soup. So what we need to do is make sure we argue for permissionless innovation. The idea that individuals will rise. This is the great benefit of Julian Simon's kind of argument. The greatest resource is the human imagination. We are tremendous problem-solving individuals. Today's inefficiency is tomorrow's profit opportunity for the person that fixes it. Do I have my phone on me? No, I left it there, but imagine this is a phone. I used to say this to my students all the time. Do you remember this commercial? Do you hear me now? Do you hear me now? Right? You don't have that commercial on anymore. I used to say to students, the guy who figures out how to get rid of dropped calls is going to, they're going to make a ton of money. Ton of money is there. People figure out how to do it. Technological innovations. If the precautionary principle comes in, we're going to end up by not allowing these innovations. So the default should always be to allow innovation and not eliminate or limit innovation until it can be proven in advance that it will never cause any harm. That's a hard argument, right? So again, let me admit something to all of you. Going back to the first graphs that I was doing, did you notice the little trick there? I just sensed that Jerry Gunderson said the United States economy was this tremendous entrepreneurial economy. Then I showed you a graph showing the rise of regulatory burden. We became more entrepreneurial, right, during the Great Moderation, and we became more regulatory. Boettke must be wrong. No? Right? We grew in spite of those regulations, but now what's wrong with that argument? It's a counterfactual. That's an extremely hard empirical argument to make. So how can you make it? In all deference to everyone here, that requires that you embrace theory. You have to embrace economic theory to be able to explain not only the patterns, but also to address the counterfactuals. Hayek addresses this in the very first volume of Lawlessness and Liberty in the chapter on expediency versus principle. And he argues, and very explicitly, that principle will always lose out to expediency in a direct cost-benefit test. Because you can't really, just what I did, you can't identify. It's the path not taken. Whereas you can do the other one, you can show the direct things. All it is Bastiat's direct and indirect effects. Right? It's the same kind of argument. We have to embrace and be able to study that, to study the effects of entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is the pattern of resource use that takes place when the hoodlum doesn't break the window. And then you trace out all the ways in which it goes, but it's not immediately obvious to you because it goes in all kinds of multiple directions. So what are those rules that cultivate real entrepreneurial ventures and not orchestrated ones? Again, sort of security of property, sound money, responsible fiscal policy. All right, all the components of the Economic Freedom Index also line up with components to create an entrepreneurial society. Go back to that present value calculation. What happens if you have irresponsible fiscal policy? It means you're not going to make that calculation as wisely as you otherwise would, because you'll be bailed out. That's what generates irresponsible fiscal policy, is a bailout nation. So, rules that cultivate real entrepreneurship, not orchestrated ones. So what's going on here? Well, as you guys have been talking about, Josh mentioned and others, I mean, Josh constructed this. So he can tell you more about it than I could. He's forgotten more about it than I can ever learn about it. But what's going on, by the way, this is bad, not good. We're going up in our rankings, down in our rankings, I guess. It's weird. We used to be number two, now we're 16. Now, what did you say was the percentage, Josh?
It's like 0.6%
of the decline. So it's not that countries are just leapfrogging us, it's that we literally are declining. We're still in the mostly free camp, all right? So it's still the case the United States has more freedom than a lot of other places. None of us would get on a plane and go to the Congo tomorrow to say, hey, let's set up our business, right? But you know, we would still come here, but we're not as well off as we once were, which shows up back in those earlier numbers in the environment of hiring people. Right? Many of you know this, but Casey Mulligan, for example, has written a lot on how over the last 10 to 15 years, what we've done is we've raised the cost of hiring people and lowered the cost of not getting a job. And so right now we have some of the lowest labor market participation rates in the history of the United States that we've recorded, under 63%. So that's what's going on with that, right? That's what you have to ask. And that's all connected up into this situation here. So does that mean we're going to go to hell in a handbasket tomorrow? No. Go back to the counterfactual, right? Here's Adam Smith. The natural effort of every individual to better his own condition when suffered to exert itself with freedom and security is so powerful a principle that it alone, and without any assistance, is not only capable of carrying on society to wealth and prosperity, but of surmounting 100 impertinent obstructions which the folly of human laws too often encumbers its operation. And you can even read it in the original. Okay? Right here. So, what's Smith saying here, right? So it's a kind of a fascinating story that Smith is telling us. He gives us a lot of fantastic propositions that need to be mined and analyzed. The most famous, of course, is division of labor is limited by the extent of the market. So people explore and think about that, right? It's not from the benevolence of the butcher, the baker, or the brewer that we expect our dinner or whatever. It's from the regard to their self-love. People have explored that. What I'm suggesting is that you guys should be looking at this kind of idea too, and what might be tipping points in which you get to so many obstructions that, for example, we know in Venezuela, black marketeers couldn't get around everything in Venezuela. It's not like they didn't exist, but they couldn't realize the positive gains from trade. But yet, we can realize positive gains still yet today. So can we make it maybe a little easier for us to do that? And this is my last warning or note here. So for those of you who are into Austrian business cycle theory, what I want to suggest to you is the following. Imagine you have a factor productivity curve, okay? And you have a factor productivity curve, some combination of K and L, some output Y, some, right? And then what we're gonna have is then we're gonna have increases in what? Trade and technology and whatnot that shift that curve up. For most of a progressing economy, what that means is that tomorrow's trough is still higher than today's peak. It's not as high as it otherwise would have been, but it's still the progress by trade and technology has offset the deviations from the trend that are caused by the manipulation by government of the distortion of the signals in the economy. So you just do a boom and bust against the trend on that productivity curve, and what you're going to see is that tomorrow's trough is still higher than today's peak. That means we're better off. But there are societies, by the way, where tomorrow's peak is lower than today's trough. And what causes that? It's when we kill trade and technology. When we destroy the institutions that make those activities possible and encourage them. And that is something that we economists have to do a much better job of communicating to the popular, you know, populace about. So our refined academic studies are necessary. We need to have the best arguments. You need to explore and study, right? Without any kind of idea that's even connected to an argument for liberty. Just you want to figure things out. You should unleash your natural curiosity to do, like, you know, what Feynman says, the pleasure of finding things out. All right? But the knowledge that we get from that, we can then use and employ to make for better policy. And if we are in a situation where policy is curtailing trade, like in the rise of protectionism around the world today, or concerns with technology, like precautionary principles, or Luddites coming in and telling us, oh my God, robots are going to take our jobs from us, and these kind of things, we need to do our job and explain how it is that progress actually takes place. And progress, I contend, takes place through the entrepreneurial channel. And so we have to free that up. But anyway, thank you very much. And I hope it wasn't as bad as Babe Zacharias' husband. All right, thanks.